Hello, hey, my name is Angel and I'm here today to talk to you about the ship alarm and monitoring systems. They are part of ship automation and very critical and very crucial for the whole ship operation. It is very important for you to know how to select the proper equipment, how to design a system to cover all the requirements from the classification societies, of course from the ship owners, shipyards and so on. So we will be talking today about the basic requirements. We will start with the small size of ships. So basically classification requirements are all ship sizes more than 35 meters to have alarm and monitoring system which is to cover the requirements for this particular vessel sizes. This classification societies, they also have a number of signals, critical signals that need to be recorded and need to be monitored all the time for safety purposes and records. For example, signals like the main engine shutdowns, main engine slowdown signals, high temperature, low temperature, whatever is related to the engine critical alarms. Of course, generators critical alarms, like high temperature, low pressure, which will cause the ship to black out. And this is very critical because without power, the vessel may be not able to maneuver. So, also, it is very important to monitor the fuel tanks all the time. Because, you know, if overflow or leaking or something like this, it may cause a fire, which is totally not a good thing. A part of the fuel tanks also need to be monitored, the freshwater tanks, because the crew needs the freshwater all the time, right? Else is the bilge levels. If the seawater penetrates the engine room, there are bilge wells that collect this bilge water. But when they go full, the crew need to know because they need to go and empty the bilge wells. Because the ship may start inclining in a not so good position. Okay, of course, there are also several other factors like a fire alarm system, bridge navigation system, and so on. I will explain to you a bit more what else is included in the basic alarm and monitoring system. So, what I say basic is because the alarm monitoring system is the first and the core of the ship automation. This can be extended to extension alarm system, can be extended to integrated also to power management system, to valve controls, pump control, fan control, cargo control, tank gauging monitoring, which is basically the part, automatic ballasting and deballasting systems, anti-heeling systems for the ship, for the firefighting, CCTV if you want, and so many more. So, but the basis need to be there. basically, the automation comprises of workstations and POCs. POCs are doing all the programming, all the controls, all the monitoring, the signals with the ranges, limits, and so on. And they can be programmed to trigger a notification or so-called alarm, so the crew will know what is happening. There are workstations as well, from which the crew will monitor to see actually what is the alarm given. or just to monitor the levels of the temperature, the levels of pressure, the levels of the liquids inside the tanks. There are a number of parameters which needs to be monitored all the time. That's why are the workstations. Also, there are some small panels which used to be like extension alarm. For example, for the different cabins, in the chief engineer cabin, in the second engineer, third or fourth, depends on the size of the ship, there can be many so-called duty engineers. They're also in the mess rooms, the restrooms, where the crew go to have lunch. So they have to be notified all the time, especially when the ships are under UMS notation. UMS means unmanned machinery space, where the machinery space is, there is nobody there, no engineer, nobody. Like the engine room is the machinery space. So they can leave it without somebody monitor the machinery all the time. Because the automation system, the alarm and monitoring system, is monitoring all the parameters, and in case anything happens, it will extend the signal to one of the cabins. Depends, again, how many cabins and which engineer is on duty. Alright? So, the alarm and monitoring system actually is not something complicated. It is only alarm and monitoring is the basic, without controls. Signals that will be sent out to column lights for notifications, to buzzers, to bell or whatever, is just a signal going out. It's not a control. But as I said, this kind of systems can be extended to have a control as well, to everything you can imagine, including the propellers, including the engines, generators, the power, the main switchboard, pumps, valves, whatever you can imagine can be extended a lot. So I will use my whiteboard to draw the few components, the core components of the basic alarm and monitoring system. First we start with workstations. Okay, why two? I will tell you why two. This is one of the classification requirements. Because if one of them fail, the other one must continue. Next, very important. Ethernet switch. Again, one. Ethernet switch, two. Why there are two? Again, because all of these components, they have to communicate each other at all the times. I will come to the communication after I show you the one. So let's say I can split this. Into area. Okay? This is ECR. Engine control room ECR. ER, engine room. This is the engine room. And this is wheelhouse, or some people call it bridge. So this equipment, the workstations and the Ethernet switches, normally installed in the engine control room, or so-called engine control console. Engine control console is ECC. Alright? So here is our monitoring part. But we are monitoring the machinery inside the engine room. So here are different machinery, main engine, generators. Sometimes the main engines are two, three, four, can be four engines. Generators also can be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and many. So here there are also many other machinery, like pumps, valves, fans, ventilation fans. All the machinery is inside the engine room. It's inside the engine room. So this machinery we monitor for the safety. So here is our let me draw it like this. POCs. This POC is getting all the signals from all the machinery. From all the machinery receiving the signals. Of course, depends on the number of machinery and the number of signals, we can put more. We can put more and more and more, depends on the number of machinery. We need to cover the total signals, all the available signals that need to be monitored. We need to provide a provision, or so-called a PLC, termination terminals, signals or channels, somewhere called channels, to the POCs. This will include signals from main engines, generators, pumps, bilge, tanks, and so on and so on and so on. From all the available machinery in the engine room, also I will separate here wheelhouse. This area is also called accommodation. Accommodation. Here are the cabins of the crew. Cabin 1, cabin 2, and so on. Mess room. Where people have lunch there in the crew. So, mess room also have galley. Okay, my mistake. And here in the galley, some ships, the bigger ones, they have freezer room. So so-called provisional. This also can send signal to the PLC, so we can monitor the temperature of the freezer room. In case temperature go higher or the room is not working, it will trigger signal, then the alarm monitoring system will receive it, extend to the people, to the engineers on duty. So back to our two workstations, two Ethernet switch, and how and why we need two. To communicate via each other, all of this, they have this so-called ring network topology. Like this. Let's say we'll name this red one will be the main network. Main. And the blue one will be backup network. Backup. Okay? So the two switch, they communicate via each other all the time. So if one fail, number two will know this, cannot detect number one, and all the communication will be coming from here. So main network going to the PLCs also. Then the backup, they also have a backup network. All these PLC, they communicate via each other like this. So my number one workstation have one main network and one backup network. Alright? One backup network. B. My workstation 2 have also you see what I mean now? Workstation 1 have main and backup. Two networks. Workstation 2 also have main and backup. Alright? So they communicate with this switch and with this switch. This one also with this and with this. They're here. It's like this. Let me tell you why this is all of them have two networks. Let's say I lost this cable broke for some reason. Okay? My PLCs will continue to communicate with the two server via the main network. Alright? So the communication will not be lost at all. We will still have communication here, even with one cable fail. Alright? Same way, if you lose this one, main cable, main network fail, our PLCs will still be able to communicate with the switch 2 and with the two workstations. And because these are two interconnected, so switch number one will also see this network. Alright? Same with the workstations. If one of the networks is gone, one network is gone, they can continue to communicate via the backup network. Right? Another thing. My workstation one gone because this is a computer. This is a computer. Spoiled for some reason. Computers have a low life cycle. 2-3 years, gone, spoiled. 5-10, depends. Some of them may work forever, some of them may spoil very fast. It's a computer. So, my number one is gone. This means no main network, no backup network. Gone, spoiled. But my workstation 2 continue to communicate with the two switches and in the same time with all the PLCs. Or so-called I/O modules. I/O modules. I/O means input, output. Input, output modules. PLC module. Right? So they will still continue to communicate. Let me restore. This means if one of them fail, you will not be completely blind. You will still have your monitoring system. You monitor all the parameters of all the machinery via workstation 2. And say, if the workstation 2 fail, one will continue monitoring. How about if the switch fail? One of them is gone. Then my workstation 2 can also communicate with the switch 1, with the workstation 1, with all the PLC. You understand? This is called a ring network topology. Any of the line fail, the rest, the communication will not be lost. If two line fail, then it is lost. No trace. But this is called redundancy. Communication redundancy, which is a very important thing. One of them fail, the other one continue. Now, another very important factor for the hardware, for this system, is the power supply. By class requirement, UPS. Now, mostly of the chip automation systems, they work with 24 volt DC supply. 24 volts, because it's less dangerous than the AC. So the UPS, you know, you have inside have batteries, and by class requirement, if the main power supply is gone, the system should be able to operate for 30 minutes on batteries. For 30 minutes at least, this system should be able to operate. So let's say there is a blackout, there is no AC power supply, the UPS will continue to supply power to all the components for at least 30 minutes. And I believe 30 minutes is more than enough for the crew, for the engineers to trace what is the problem and to rectify it. So basically it's all called to recover the blackout. The UPS is very important for the classification societies. Some of the classification societies, for example, DMVGL. DMVGL says if your automation system have control functions, means it is no longer AMS, then it becomes, it's, some people call it in a different way, this one we are talking about AMS, right? Alarm and monitoring system. when there is a control, some say MCMS, machinery control and monitoring system. Some say IAS, integrated automation system. Depends on the supplier of the system. They have their own name for the for their systems. For example, we also have this. My company also, when we supply the alarm monitoring system, it's AMS. When we integrate with other systems and input control, we call it VMS, Vessel Management System. Because this system is managing everything, the integration, the controls, the monitoring, everything. That's why I call VMS. So, back to the UPS. DIN VGL requires to have two UPS if your system have controls. If your PLC can control pumps, fan, engines, generators, whatever. Two UPS. Double redundancy. Okay? Despite the fact that the UPS have primary supply, let's say power supply 1 is 220 volts AC. Have secondary supply, number 2, which is 24 volt DC. AC voltage from the switchboard, from the main switchboard supply, then the UPS will convert to 24 volt DC, supply to the systems, to the automation. In case my primary supply is gone, I still have the secondary supply from the emergency switchboard, which is from the ship batteries, also similar like UPS. So I still have 24 volt supply. In case all of them are down, no power supply to my UPS, then my batteries will continue supply to the AMS. So basically the automation system is the last one to which will remain working in a ship. Main switchboard gone, generators cannot supply the AC power. The emergency switchboard also gone, the batteries also already drained, cannot use the batteries. My UPS will continue supply, then the workstation will continue monitoring the alarms and the statuses of all the things, because when the crew is busy to so-called to rectify what is the problem, why the AC power is gone, why the DC power is gone. This bilge, for example, the seawater can penetrate inside, start filling up the engine room, the machinery, everything will go wet. While the people is working, they are not monitoring what is happening here, but the system is monitoring. The tanks also, same, but your automation system is still working and still can monitor what is happening and can notify the crew when necessary, always. So when there is a control, DIN-VGL requires two UPS. In case one of the UPS fail, the other one should still continue to supply. This is called single point of failure. A single point of failure should not interrupt the operation. For example, my Ethernet switch, single point of failure. If my Ethernet switch is down, my system continue working or not? Yes, our system is continue to work via Ethernet switch. Even this one is gone. Okay? Okay, that's it. Short. Switch two. Same way. If my workstation is gone, I can still operate my system. Single point of failure. Even this one is gone. Okay? Okay, that's it. Short. Switch two. Same way. If my workstation is gone, I can still operate my system. Single point of failure. One line, cable gone, single point of failure. I still can operate. UPS 2, my UPS 1 have some problem for some reason. Single point of failure. That's why 2. That's why there are 2. When the system have control. Okay? Control maybe depends on the ship, depends on the requirements. Let's say it is something complicated. Let's say we have the auto-healing system. The auto-healing, I will just quickly give you an explanation what is the auto-healing. This is the ship core, right? Looking from front of the ship. This is the ship center. Here is my port side tank. And here is my starboard side tank. Then the ship is moving left and right. Right? Ship is moving left and right always. This is 0 degree. But what if the ship have more weight here? On its port side. On its starboard, nothing. So it will incline to here, right? So it will go like this. Let's say 2 degrees. The system then will calculate, we see, and it will take some liquid from here to this type. So this will go down. The water here will go down and here will go up. So this side will be more heavier and it will balance the ship back to 0 degree. This is the auto healing system. So this is a setting. If the ship go more than 2 degrees inclination, the system start. This means open the valve, start the pump the liquid here, and opposite, ship go port side, minus 2 degree. Again, open this valve, start pumping from here to here. Actually, it is quite easy if you think just filling the tanks from one to another, in order to balance the healing. This side moving of the ship is called heeling. When the ship is moving, okay, let's say this is the ship. This is a side view. Side view, huh? The ship is moving here, up and down. This is called trim. trim and heal. Or some people call it list. Alright? But the trim is not that dangerous for the ship. It's not that dangerous. The healing, yes. Because the ship can capsize. Some ship more than 10 degree inclination capsized already. So that's why DNVGL, this classification society, requires to have two UPS. So single point of failure will not interrupt the controls when there are controls. Okay. This is the basic alarm monitoring system functionality, excluding the controls. Later on we will add in the controls, but now this is excluding the controls. So under UMS notation, unattended machinery space. Okay? So as I said, all the machinery is inside engine room, also called the machinery space, unattended machinery space, or unmanned is the same. What does this notation mean for the alarm and monitoring system? This means this, let's say this here is the entrance door to the engine room. This is the entrance. So here there will be a box with selector switch from which you can select attended machinery space, unattended machinery space. This means when the machinery space is attended, there is a system called dead man system. Dead man. What is the dead man system meaning? When the engineer go inside and start working into the machinery room, this dead man system have a timer, let's say 30 minutes. 30 minutes is like a default. So this is the so-called the watch entrance unit, watch entrance unit, which is at the entrance of the engine room. So when the engineer go inside, he switch on this watch entrance unit, and 30 minutes timer is starting to count. Inside, in the engine room, there are a lot of machinery, right? Yeah, engines, generators, pumps, whatever. A lot of machinery. So let's say this is the engine, here is the generator, here is another generator, here is some small equipment. Then the person will go to the engine, work, or the generator, or to another machinery. Right? It's a lot of machinery, and sometimes in a different levels, inside the engine room. So inside the engine room, on a key locations, there are a few boxes located. Few box. This box is called reset box. This box and the watch entrance unit, they are apart from the dead man system or so-called functionality. That means it's the functionality of the AMS system, which is monitoring as per the UMS requirement. What is this meaning? When the engineer go inside, the engineer go inside, switch to position on, 30 minutes timer is starting. So he go inside, start working. Then upon 27 minutes, this reset boxes, this is a light with a button, illuminated push button. It will start flashing to notify the engineer that the timer is about to expire. So he will have to go reset the timer. Then the timer is back to 30 minutes again and he can continue working. So the point and the idea of this dead man system is inside the engine room is very noisy. All this machinery are huge. It is very noisy. If this engineer hit his head somewhere or fell down, he starts shouting, nobody will hear. You understand what I mean? So when the timer is finished, the system will trigger alarm in the whole ship. In the whole ship, everywhere, whatever is a buzzer, whatever is a bell, a sounder, anything, all will sound. Means dead man. So somebody have to go and search for this engineer. Something happened to him. Something happened to him because he couldn't reset the timer. He couldn't go out within this time. So this is why this is exactly why the system is called dead man. To prevent from it will not prevent from injury, but it will save a person if the person hit his head or his arm or broke his leg, broke the leg, then fell down. As much as you're shouting, nobody will hear because it's too noisy there. So that's why is this system. So when the engineer finished working, of course, everything is fine, he is not injured. Engineer finished working and he will go back, he will go out, switch off the timer. So the timer will stop. Alright? The timer will stop. Then close the door. Means engine room now is unattended. Nobody in the engine room. Nobody. Right? So this is the purpose of this dead man system, comprising of watch entrance unit and alarm reset box. Alarm reset. So the UMS notation also says when the engine room is unattended, there should be an engineer on duty who will be monitoring the situation. If anything happens, he's on duty and he will receive the signal. Let's say nighttime. During the nighttime, nobody is working, but somebody still have to monitor the machinery because the ship is continue to work. It's continue sailing, it's continue doing some job, even if it's a tugboat, they're working all the time. So there are a few engineers, mostly first one is the chief engineer, then the second engineer, third engineer, electrician, depends on the size of the ship, they can be many. So inside the accommodation, and the mess room, galley, yes. This is Chief Engineer Kevin. Second engineer.
Kevin.
Third. And so on. There can be many. Can be only one. Depends on the size of the ship. Okay? So each of these cabin, including the mess room, it will have extension alarm panel. Extension alarm panel. Bridge or warehouse will also have this extension alarm panel. So these three have the option to select which one will be on duty. Let's say in this case our second engineer is on duty. Our second engineer is on duty. The engine room is unattended. The system is switched, there is attended or unattended mode, which means this unattended, nobody in the engine room, nobody is working. Then all the alarms, what is happening here, for example, tank level is go up or some machinery pressure go down or something like this. All this, any alarm occur, it will sound here in the engineer on duty extension alarm panel. Also, it will sound in the mess room. In case the engineer go for lunch or for dinner, he is not in his room. He is in the mess room. But still, he can see what is the status. Then he can run down, go to the control room, see on the monitors, acknowledge the alarm, stop the horn, go back. Go check if it's something critical. If it's something not critical, go back again, continue my dinner. Right? Or go back sleep. They are every day different person on duty. Next day it will be the third engineer, after that it will be the chief engineer, then after that the second, after that the third, and so on. These are the duty engineers. Same way, my chief engineer is on duty. Any alarm occur, it will sound here. And in the mess room. These three panels, they can be set on duty. Bridge or workhouse one and the mess room one, they cannot be set on duty. This is the system functionality, a basic system functionality. This is part of the unmanned machinery space or so-called unattended machinery space. Right? So these panels also can display any alarm occur, but it will not sound if it's set to attended mode. Somebody is inside and working, there is some other alarm not related to this work. This will also display, but it will not sound. There are many different settings that can be done for this panel. They can sound always, doesn't matter who is on duty, doesn't matter if it's attended or unattended mode, they may not sound. Bridge panel also the same. Because for some small ships, there is only one chief engineer without the rest and the master, ship master. So if the chief engineer is having a rest, It's nighttime, but the ship is continue working. The master is continue driving the ship. He still need to know if any alarm related to the engines or the machinery is coming. He still need to know his ship engines are okay or not. Should stop or not. Should be able to maneuver or not. They still need to know. Because that's why I say this extension alarm panels are very so-called very open. Can be, the settings can be changed according to the requirements, firstly to cover the class requirements, and second depends on the operation type of the ships, how they are basically operating, how they do, because let's say for some crew, the master don't want to know any of this. Machinery is the engineer's responsibility. Master is responsible to drive the ship only. So that's why I say this is the settings of these panels are highly adjustable. Depends on the requirements, depends on the personal preferences, and so on. So yes, this is more or less the alarm and monitoring system. So this alarm and monitoring system, of course, can be extended to many others, to cargo control and so on. Let's say can be many POC. Can be many. Let's say this one is pump control. This one is valve control. Tank monitoring. This main engine, generator, and so on and so on and so on. As many as machinery you have on board, this can monitor and can extend until depends on the system. More than 20,000 IO points. Hardware IO points. Software IO points are different. So each one is a hardware IO point. Let's say pump control. Number one pump is running. This is one signal. Number one pump is in a remote mode. Remote means I can control from here. Another signal. Number one pump have low pressure. Number one pump have power failure. Already four, five signals already. Only for one pump. Five input signal. Then this number one pump stuck. Output stop. Again output. That's why input output IO. So you see we have seven signal for one pump only. What if you have 200? Or no, for pumps it's too much. Pumps, let's say 20, 30 pumps, but valves, 200 valves. Each valve, almost the same. 4 or 5 signals per valve. Then become so many, so many. Then you have fan, you have tanks, you have a lot of stuff. You have air cons, ventilation, a lot of stuff. Each have many, many. So continue counting. So for each you need to add in the PLCs. So these PLCs, they still have to communicate via each other with the main system. So it will be like this. All right. Sometimes we can do like this. Not all of them interconnected. Let's say this. These four connected to interlinked by each other. Then the next three, each other. Then the next three, and the next three. Like this. So you basically have more redundancy and more options to cover all the controls. And depends on the ship again, and depends on the number of I/O, depends on the number of controls you may have. Another workstation. Three. You may have four. So cool. These two can be separated inside the engine control room. These two can be put inside cargo control room. So these two can control the pumps and the tanks and everything. These two only can monitor the engine and the generator parameters, and can control also the generators. Can be separated like this based on the requirements. It is something common, but also in the same time can be made all of them to be able to control at any time whatever they want. Just this is done in case. This is one console, cargo control console, CCC. This is another console. So if I'm controlling from here, then this one should not be able to control. Alright, this is the purpose why they is separated like this. But as I said, still there is an option to do this from different places, different locations. This is the basic. So from this can be extended to power management system, can be extended to many, many others. And I will give you, we'll show you how. The control system looks like, control console looks like. All right? This is the control console. You see the two workstation? Then from here, you can see the power management. On the other screen, you can see the fuel consumption, what is happening, the pump system can control start stop and so on. This is how the control console looks like. Let's say this can be engine control console, this can be cargo control console, depends. So with this one, we'll stop here and you wait for the next topic. Let's say to understand how this input-output is working and what is the difference between hardware and software, and also how many communication protocols have, how to make the two systems communicate each other, speaking both different language, and how this system will interpret these signals to receive it properly. It's a different story. Because to make the system, architecture, hardware is fine. But how will this system receive the signals and how will the system act upon receiving these signals? How it will talk with different machinery? This we will talk another time. See you again, guys. Have a good day.